So we're shooting the record company, skip ahead, I don't know, a year and a half, we were
I'm
I know there's more to that record.
No. That's a song that a lot of people really dig. But you know what, Warren, let me ask you. So, since you joined the band, you know, and it already existed, with Jake, studio. You were saying before that, you know, in the earliest days of when you were in RATT, it wasn't, you know, overflowing fountains of money and limousines and all of those other things. You just were given, like, here's your slot in the studio, get to work. So how much time did you have, or, you know, to make that record?
On that record, it was very worked out to be, so many days for basics, you know, bass and drums,
right.
And then so many days to you know, do guitars, and everything was very worked out. So I think we did that whole thing in 21 days,
wow.
not including the mixing.
Yeah, no, that's bad. So did you go out?
You know, one was Lay It Down.
Don't stop. What are you stopping for?
Solo. Do the solo.
Tunes, I think, are not tuned down a half step, but that's most of the other stuff is. So what? How come? And was that something in the band where you just had tunes that were tuned down a half step and tunes that weren't, and you went back and forth? It seems like most tunes were down a half step, but the drop D tunes were not. And I know that, right. And I know that Wakefield Jr. is not tuned down a half step. That's normal. So I don't know if you could shed some light on why things changed.
Dropping the whole, we tuned the on those two records at least, we tuned the whole guitar from 840 down to 8 flat. And when, I think when it's down a half step and then you tune a whole nother whole step. maybe just a little too loose.
Right.
I'm not sure, actually. Okay. But I like the playing. I like the sound a little better when it's tuned up to 8440. The guitar in general is designed for that. It's just that, to me, it sounds a little brighter, a little, you know. But that's true. We did tune up to 8440 and then just drop the D thing.
Thank you.
So how did this one come about, you know? And, you know, how did this particular one come about and the design of it and all that?
This was just Glenn and Dan. Glenn Matazel and Dan Lawrence were the main people in the art department at Charvel during this kind of period where a lot of the guitars came from between, I'm not sure when they started, but when I was collaborating with them, it was like from 83 to 87. So this was just one of the things that I believe Glenn did and just brought over one day. And I was just like, wow, man. Because he was just such a great artist that it was like, you know, it was more than just a guitar sometimes. But that's kind of how this one came out. It's a little heavier.
It is heavier.
And I didn't, this one also had that 1 7/8 inch neck on it. And it was just one of that group from that period. And this is pretty much it. This one is. And then the. Yeah.
Well, this is another iconic guitar for you, absolutely, you know.
This one, Mike Shannon just took a regular strap body and one of the bands on, just cut it into a telly kind of thing. There's almost no contour except for here. And Grover gave me four bodies, one that was white, one that was red, black, and I asked for one with absolutely no finish, and that one ended up being the snake guitar because we figured that putting a snake on a finished guitar made it really dark. It was just too much. And so to get around that kind of loss of sound, tried pointing it directly to the wood, which helped. Now it's, you barely notice it because it's been so long, but when we first made those, it just had a darkness to it. So that's what, how those came about. So one was a snake and then one ended up being this, which that bass player that was telling us about going to each other's kids' parties and stuff. And I remember I got a hold of a tape of Jimi Hendrix's Band of Gypsies at the Fillmore, which was another sort of turning point for me when I heard that record. And I didn't know that there was any visual footage, you know, to that at all. There was never any bootlegs around or anything like that. I just figured that there was only that one shot of the cover, you know what I mean? And that was all there was from that gig. But I was like, you know, I remember I had just got that tape, and Michael and George and I were watching it, you know, and we got through about 20 minutes of it, and then all of a sudden, I just noticed, you know, someone was moving around, but you know how you're when you're watching something, we're really focused on this, because this is so burned into our DNA, and it's just like actually seeing the image of what was happening, you know, was just like so riveting. And then I looked, because in the room, George lived pretty far away, so he spent the night the night before, and I had two Marshalls that I was going to sell, and they were in the room he was staying in. And so I'm watching the TV, and then out of the corner of my eye, I see George with both hands, like this kind of, you know, kind of disheveled, banging around, you know, getting out the front door, and I'm like, oh, this is another George joke, right? He's going to come back. He never came back. So the next day, we were at, you know, down in Anaheim at his daughter's birthday party, really serious, the next day. And this guy comes up to me and he's like, yeah, you know, you hear about those Marshalls George has for sale? But he always wants to borrow the Plexi Marshall that I have that I recorded like Lay It Down with and You're in Love, that intro, that whole record.
Still have it?
You still have it, yeah. And they stuff shorts out and you know they stop working for a while, or you know like it I remember it every other time you turned it on, it would blow the fuse. And so there was a good 2 or 3 year period I didn't even didn't use it until I took it to Jose, and he managed to stop it from, what was happening was that he said inside the transformer there was some of the something was allowing both charge, negative, positive, negative charge to see each other. And he sprayed something in there, did something, and it worked. And it's like, once those things get working, it doesn't really want to touch them, you know? So I never lived loan it to him, because he just blow it up and go, oh, sorry. And I only used it for recording, so he's always trying to find that.